Well, good morning, everybody, and welcome to The Well Church. We are very, very glad that you're here. We are very grateful for you. We're also grateful for God for you and for this opportunity to worship with you. We're glad that you are here, and we're glad that you're able to join us online. Either way, we're glad just to have this fellowship time with you and this time to really worship God this morning. And we want to let you know that if you have any questions for us, if you want to contact us with any praises, any prayer requests, or would like to update us with any information that you might have, an email address or a phone number, you can do that if you're here by filling out our connection card. You can do that. It's right there in front of you. And you can fill that out and put it into that little brown box in the foyer. We'd love to hear from you. And if you're online, you can do the exact same thing by going to thewellyukaipa.com to the sermon and blog section to fill that out. We would love to hear from you. With that being said, we do have one video announcement from Larry, what I'm going to play for you right now.
Good morning. Last week I told you about the 21 Days of Hope. Today we begin the 21 Days of Hope Easter experience. This is a 21-day challenge our church is doing leading up to Easter. We believe as God is going to use these 3 weeks to bring hope to you and bring hope through you. This 21-day challenge is going to grow your faith and allow others to see the difference God can make in our lives. Here's how the 21 Days of Hope works. Text the word HOPE to 909-547-9757. You'll get a text message response within a few seconds, linking you to the 21 Days of Hope. Once you're in, you'll receive a daily email beginning today. Each day will help you and others experience God's love in some miraculous way. Share this with everyone and anyone, and often share it. The idea over the next 3 weeks is to help your friends, family, and acquaintances see how amazing God is. We are all going on this digital mission trip together as a church. We believe this will have a huge impact on our area as we all jump on board. Again, text HOPE to 909-547-9757. We are praying for you, and we are excited to see all that God will do through you these next 21 days. Let's do this together. Remember, text 909-547-9757, and in the message, type the word HOPE. Thank you, and have a great day.
All right, and all of this is leading up, of course, to Easter, which is about 3 weeks away. As part of that preparation, we have a few things, a few announcements for you. First of all, is we do have a work day on April the 3rd from 8 to noon, getting God's house ready for visitors for Easter time. We also have a Good Friday service on Good Friday, which is April the 2nd. We'll have that service at 7 p.m. And then finally culminating to Easter, which is coming up on April the 4th. We encourage you to invite your family, invite your friends to this special church service. What a wonderful day to celebrate God's goodness in our life. Amen. Well, I'm going to invite you to stand with us as we read this month's Bible memory verse. Revelation 1, 17 through 18. Do not be afraid. I am the first and the last. I am the living one. I was dead, and now look, I am alive forever and ever. And I hold the keys to death and Hades. Revelation 1, 17 through 18. Well, Father, we're thankful for everything you're doing through our lives. We're thankful for this opportunity to worship you right now. We set everything aside so that your goodness may come first. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Good morning. So good to be here with you all this morning, and thank you for joining us online too. Ephesians 2, 8 through 9 says, "For it is by grace that you have been saved. This is not of ourselves, it is the gift of God, and not of works, lest any man should boast. There's nothing we could do to earn God's grace, but accept him through faith and receive that free gift that he has for us. So he is the one who has called us out of darkness to walk into his marvelous light. So let's worship him this morning. Amen. Amen. Let's sing.
Breathless in awe and wonder, the King of glory, the King above all kings. Sing it out.
This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your life. That I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
Sing it out. Who breaks our chaos?
Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of glory, who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. Oh, this is amazing. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your life that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
King is worthy of all of our praise. Amen.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your life that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. All that you've done for me, yeah. Oh Jesus.
Man, he's worthy. Church, you may be seated.
The sick and the broken. There's
comfort for every heart that mourns. Our King and our Savior forever. For eternity we will sing of all you've done. For eternity we will sing of all you've done. We sing, God with us, God for us. Nothing can come against, no one can stand between us. God with us, God for us. Nothing can come against, no one can stand between.
No height, there's no depth that can separate us from the love of Christ. You together, His heart, it moves with compassion.
Your heart, it moves with compassion. There is life, there is healing in your heart. The Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. For eternity, we will sing of all you've done. We sing, God with us, God for us. Nothing can come against, no one can stand between us. God with us, God for us.
Courageous, because we take hope in the name of Jesus. We take hope in your name, Lord. So, Father, we stand here this morning. We worship you. We thank you for all that you have done, Lord, for coming and living a perfect and blameless life and dying on that cross for us, for your amazing grace, Lord, that has ultimately led us to salvation and cleansed us of our sins and our unrighteousness. There's no way
to life, but through you. So God, we worship you. You are worthy. And Lord, as we continue with our worship through our giving, Lord, help us to give. Help us to give with gratitude, with joy, with thankfulness, Lord. Help us to give not just out of a sense of obligation, but Lord, as you have been faithful to us, we want to be faithful to what you ask us to do in your word. But Father, help us to also just give out of hearts full of worship and recognizing how you have provided, how you have sustained us. So God, we give to you now as an offering of worship. We love you, Lord. In Jesus' name. If you're here this morning, you can give your gift by filling out that offering card and dropping it in the little brown box on your way out. Or if you're online, there's a banner with the different ways that you can give. Let's keep worshiping.
Great is our God. Father, we are indeed standing here in awe of how great you are. And you are the magnificent one. You are the one who created this universe with just a word. You are arrayed in power. You are on the throne of this universe, Lord. By you, all things consist. All things, Father, hold together by you. And yet, you love us. You are kindly inclined towards us. Your heart pursues us. And Lord, in all of your power and majesty and greatness, we are humbled by that very fact that you want us. And so we respond to your overtures of love. We surrender our lives to you. We give our hearts to you. And Lord, at this time, as we come together, we open our hearts to your word, and we ask that you would speak to us and encourage us, strengthen us, and give us your words of life, Lord. Change us and transform us into people after your own heart. And we ask these things in your great and your powerful and majestic name, the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. Well, it's really good to be with you here this morning. And thank you all for getting up an extra hour early to be here. And the payoff will be in 3 weeks, you're going to be sitting out on your back patio enjoying a lovely summer-like evening. And it'll be about 7:30, and the sun will be just beginning to set, and it'll be warm, and you're going to like it. So a little pain now, a little gain later, all right? So endure. You're going to be all right through this. Before we get started, from time to time, we have folks in our congregation that want to join in and be a part of our deacons team, and our deacons are the unsung hero of our church, the heroes and heroesses of our church, and they are the ones that get stuff done around here. Nothing happens in this church if it wasn't for our deacons, and so we are grateful for them, and I just want to say thank you to all of you who are serving, and a couple have come forward that have been nominated to be deacons at our church, and as we do with new deacons and elders, we go through a time of a 30-day trial period, and where our church examines their lives, actually, and it's a time where they pray and we pray. And if you have, we're going to be nominating Mark and Mia Wilhite to be deacons. And for 30 days, they're not here right now. They had to go out of town this week. And I'll introduce them when they come back and embarrass them properly in front of everyone. But I won't, because they're just very sweet and dear folks. And anyways, what we do, though, for our leaders is for 30 days, we want to invite you to talk to them and get to know them. But also, we think leaders need to be held to a very high standard at our church. And so if there's something that you have that's maybe an issue with them, we want you to go and talk to them and resolve that before they get started. And we have that period for everyone who's nominated for leadership. And we do that because we want to do two things. One, we want everyone to have their relationships straightened out and right together. And the other thing is we don't want gossiping. If you know something about Mark and Mia that you think would disqualify them, don't you dare talk to anyone else in this church about that until you talk to them about it. And not even after you talk to them. Just keep your, you know, but talk to them about it. Okay? That's the way we deal with stuff here. We if you have a problem with someone, you go and take care of it. All right? And no gossiping. It's one of the things, seven things that God hates is gossip. All right? Do you know that? So if you're someone who's prone to that, you might want to spend some time with the Lord and take care of that. But we're offering this opportunity with Mark and Mia. If you if there's something that you want to discuss with them about their lives, they're open for this, and you're welcome to do that, okay? But be kind and understand that you're a sinner who is approaching other sinners, because that's where we are, right? Okay, so just wanted to let you know, they'll be for 30 days going through this process, and then we will confirm them next month as being new deacons, all right? Okay, it's why there's not a really long list of people who want to be deacons and deaconesses, because people think, oh, there are people are going to talk to me and when I, you know, yelled at them in the Vaughn's parking lot when they took my place, you know. But anyways, just wanted to lay that out for you. We're going to be talking, we are just going to start a new series today on the book of Revelation, the last book of the Bible. And I have honestly never preached a full series through the whole book of Revelation before. So this is exciting for me. But before we get started, a couple of things. One, there is no S at the end of Revelation. Just want to say, don't say, oh, the book of Revelations. You know, nah, it's just a singular. There's no S on there. So just wanted to let you know about that. But the title of our sermon today is What in the World? Because if you read through this book, there is some crazy stuff. You read it and you're going to see some things that are just amazing. And even today, we're going to go through some things that are just really interesting. But before we start, I'm reminded of this story that I heard when I was a little kid. And there was this guy who was going around through town to these different towns. And he was kind of a grifter. He was kind of a dude who just kind of pulled shenanigans just about everywhere that he went. And so he went into this town and said, well, what can I do here? And the king heard about this guy and threw him in jail, actually, when he got into town. But then he says, well, wait a minute. Before you throw me in jail, I have something that's really important to you, your kingship, that if you allow me, I will make some clothing to you that is magic clothing. And this new clothing that you're going to get will enable you to determine who is loyal and not loyal. Because anyone who is loyal to you, King, will see this beautiful clothing and will be able to see just how glorious you are. But people that are not loyal will not be able to see these clothes. And so he spent all this time just cutting out this nothing out of air. And he was sewing it up and cutting the patterns. And everyone was watching him. And everyone was thinking, oh, no, I can't see. Maybe I'm not wise and loyal to the king. But nobody spoke up. And so the big day came. And the emperor came out to show off his new clothes. And this grifter dressed him very ornately. I think he was a part-time mime, too. Okay, you can't trust those mimes. Anyways, and so the king went out in front of everyone with invisible clothes on. And he was walking around and everyone was looking at this king and they were all saying, oh, what beautiful clothes you have, king. Until he walks down the parade in the middle of town, and everyone is just like, oh, it's glorious, you look so wonderful. And then this little kid said, Mommy, the king is naked. And then everyone realized that they'd been ripped off, right? They threw the guy in prison, the king was humiliated, and they laughed at him for the rest of his life. Right? It's a great story. One of my favorite stories. It had an impact on me as a little kid. And I think through most of my life, I've had this tendency to look at things and say, dude, you are naked. You know, I have that tendency to just tell the truth. It's actually good and bad sometimes. But as we look at this book of Revelation, it's not some magic book that's going to determine your virtue. But I want you to know that there is a million different ways to interpret the stuff that you're going to read in this. I have read so many things about what we're going to be studying for the next few months together, probably for 3 months. And a lot of different people have a lot of different opinions about it. And so what we're going to do is we're going to show one another grace, because what I'm going to share probably might be a different opinion than what you've learned. Okay? But I'm going to try my best to apply good principles of hermeneutics, which is biblical interpretation, to this. I'm going to try to present to you maybe a couple of different viewpoints on it. And I'm going to encourage you to study and make up your own minds. And I also want you to know that it's really okay if you don't agree with me, even though I'm right. But you can still, it's really okay for you to disagree with me, and it's okay for me to disagree with you. It doesn't mean, you know, my personhood is not wrapped up into this, okay? Because there's a lot of really smarter people than any of us in here that have totally divergent views upon what we're going to read, okay? But what we are going to do is we're going to look at it, and we're going to just see it for what it says, and we're going to look at the possible interpretations and how that could impact our lives right now. Because the important thing about this book of Revelation that you may not know is it's really applicable to what we're living through right now today. And we're going to see some really cool things. The main thing that we're going to see at the end of it all is two things. One, Jesus wins, and he's going to make everything new. And that's what we hang on to at the very end of it all. However it gets there, the windy trail, the path leads to the end of the story. And the end of the book is really good, because Jesus wins. And if you're allied with Jesus, then you win by virtue of his victory. Okay? All right. So, are you guys ready? This is going to be fun. I'm excited. So, as we look at this book, there's really four ways that have really come down through history of the way that people look through this. I'm going to give you a little, a 10-minute seminary lesson here. You ready? These four views of interpretation really will form the framework of how you look at the book of Revelation. And there's four different ways really throughout history that people have kind of come to their views. Some of them are a little more plausible. Some of them are not, but you're going to have to make up your minds. I really believe that you guys can make up your minds, and that you can be sensible about this, okay? All right, so the first view is an allegorical view. An allegorical view thinks that it's all just a big allegory, and just a big story. Nothing in it is literal. It just all is symbolic. And it's just this epic struggle between good and evil, and it's all symbols that we really can't understand, but that we can draw some parallels to. So that's what some people say, that none of this is real stuff. It's just symbols of other stuff. The second thing is the preterist view. Okay? The preterist view, see, I told you, isn't this life-changing? How many of you used the word preterist last week? All right. The preterist view looks at all of this stuff in Revelation as if it already happened in the first century of the Roman Empire. Some people see everything that happened in Revelation as if the guy who wrote it in the time that he wrote it had witnessed everything that went on, and he was writing in a secret code about everything that happened. And it's all done. And nothing in it is really, except for the very end, that Jesus is going to come back someday, but kind of, they even say that, is that he's already set up his kingdom here on earth and he's working it out. Okay? That's what some people believe. The third group of people see it as historical and as a symbolic representation of church history through all the ages. And so, really, everything that's happening is, if you look back in church history, you can apply everything to things that have happened over the last 2,000 years. The problem with that is that time keeps going on. And the guys that believed this one in 1850, how do they account for the things that have happened in the last 170 years? So there's a historical view. The fourth one is the futuristic view. And that is, everything after chapter 4 in the book of Revelation, and we'll talk about the structure of the book as we move through it, but everything after chapter 4 is in the future. That there's history up until in Revelation 1 through 3, it talks about what was going on, but after chapter 4, then that's the future from the time that it was written. Now, here's what I believe, and this is where we might begin to be divergent a little bit. I kind of believe that there's a little bit of truth in all of those, actually. And it's kind of an eclectic view. But mostly, I'm a futurist. I'm falling into camp number 4, personally. Anything other than this approach, it leaves the book too much open to human ingenuity and opinion. And we all become like the people in the towns who are seeing whatever the emperor was wearing as what we've created in our own minds. The futurist approach, it takes the book's meaning, I think, as God gave it and laid it out for us. And I think it's the simplest way. In science, there's a theory, and in mathematics and in physics, it's called Occam's razor. And Occam's razor is really the simplest approach is probably the most likely the truth. Okay? And if we apply that here as well, generally speaking, if we just kind of look at it for what it's saying and don't try to read too much because it's all from our own experience when we start reading a lot of our own stuff into it. So we're going to go, in studying Revelation, we're going to take this straightforward view of the futurist, and we're going to see some of the allegorical parts, some parts that are obviously history, and see how it applies through the history of the church until the present day. So we're going to kind of use some things from all of these different perspectives. But it's nearly impossible to consider all the interpretive options offered by people having all these other views, and we're not going to work through all of the options. There has to be some things that I'm going to leave out, because I would preach on this for 15 years, honestly. It's so rich and so full. So we're kind of going to zoom through, you know, but what we're going to do is, if you need to talk about some of the other stuff, talk about it in your small groups, or set up a meeting, and I'd love to just have a cup of coffee and talk about this stuff, okay? That's kind of what I like to do. All right, so you ready to get started? All right, turn to chapter 1, Revelation. Revelation's the last book in the Bible. It's the last one written. Go all the way to the very back, and now you got to go a little bit further, a little bit less than all of those word lists at the back, and you know all the maps. You got to go back a little to the left of that, but it's the last book in the Bible, and we're going to start with chapter 1. And I've generally found that's a good way to do it. You know, though, that when they wrote the Bible, they didn't have chapters and verses written in. They were like letters, and they didn't like have all. This was added in a little bit later, and it actually is helpful because that way we know where we want to go. But let's look at Revelation chapter 1, and we'll start with verse 1, the very beginning. And this is what it says. The revelation from Jesus Christ, which God gave him to show his servants what must soon take place. He made it known by sending his angel to his servant John. So there's the first clue of who wrote the book of Revelation. John, and the angel brought it to him, who testifies to everything he saw, that is, the word of God and the testimony of Jesus Christ. So this is John, and he's giving testimony. He's writing and saying, listen, this is what I've seen, this is what I've heard, and I'm writing it down. And it's about Jesus, and it's about the word of God. Verse 3, blessed is the one who reads aloud the words of this prophecy. I'm excited because I get to read this aloud to you guys. And so I'm getting a big blessing out of this. Blessed is the one who reads aloud the words of this prophecy, and blessed are those who hear it. Oh, so you're getting a blessing too. And who take to heart what is written in it, because the time is near. The time is near. Amazing. The time is near. Now, This was written 2,000 years ago. Now, the time is near. In God's economy of time, I think that God lives outside of time, actually. I don't think yesterday or tomorrow or today really means anything in context of God's existence. I think he exists here, and time exists here, and God is beyond and above it all. So it is very near for God. Remember, the Bible says a day is like 1,000 years. There's a story of a guy who is praying to God, and he says, God, is it true that like a day is worth 1,000 years for you? And God said, yes. And he says, is it like a second is like 1,000 years to you? And he said, of course. And he said, so would that mean that like a penny is worth like $10 billion to you? And God said, yeah. And the guy says, well, God, can I have a penny? And he said, just a second. So this issue of time for us seems kind of stretched out, you know? But for God, man, it's right there. It's you know what God always says about himself? He says, I am. He never says I was or I'm going to be. He just says I am. And God is constantly present. And so for him, the time being soon, it's soon. It's right there for him, okay? So this word revelation, the revelation from Jesus, the word revelation is also in the Latin translated and in the Greek as well. It's apocalypsis, okay? And the apocalypse, you know, you think of the apocalypse and you're thinking of a genre of movies, Mad Max, Waterworld, you know, all of those great movies. You think of the apocalypse, the end of all stuff. Well, the word apocalypse actually doesn't mean the end of it all. It means an unveiling or a revelation of something. That's what apocalypse means. It just means that the curtain's being drawn back and you're seeing the man behind the curtain. It's an unveiling. God is unveiling to us this revelation, this apocalypse of what's going to be going on in the world. He's kind of given us a peek behind the curtains. And he does this through an angel, actually. The angel came and spoke to John. Angels are messengers in the Bible. That's what the word angel means. It means a herald or someone that just brings messages. And this revelation, man, it's a strange book, and it's full of bizarre images that we're going to see, like locusts with human faces. That's kind of creepy. Kind of weird. Tails that sting like scorpions. Weird. Ugh. A woman clothed with the sun. That is a dazzling dress you have on, dear. Yes. A beast with 7 heads and 10 horns. It's like Godzilla, kind of. Strange, and so on, you know, just weird things. And Revelation's uniqueness results from its genre as this prophetic, apocalyptic letter. And God uses these angels to bring this message. For them, this is a realm that they're familiar with. For us, it seems a little bit bizarre. Now, who wrote this? It was the author. He says here his name is John. There's several different ideas about who John was, and people have had opinions about who John is. The earliest disciples from the first and second centuries believed that it was John the Apostle, the friend of Jesus. And a few hundred years, they kind of started having debates about it. I'm going with the early guys. I think it was just the guy who wrote the Gospel of John, 1st, 2nd, and 3rd John. And there's a thousand reasons of why people would have arguments about this. And I'm like, dude, the people that were closest to it said it was John. I'm going with that. And if I'm wrong, then it was another John, okay? But I think that it was John the Apostle. He was probably in his 80s when he wrote it, 80s or 90s. Some of you who might be a little further down the road might be wondering, what is God doing with me in my life? God used John in his 80s or 90s to write the last book of the Bible. God is not done with us. He's not done with any of you sitting in this room right now. Any of you watching on the internet right now that are live streaming this or looking at it on YouTube, God is not done with you because you're here and he's got something for you. Figure that out. He was the brother of James. He was the Apostle John. The time he wrote it was about AD 95 or 96, so probably 60 years after Jesus was living on the earth. And so it was a good period of time had gone through. A lot of things were happening. The setting of this book was during the evil Roman Empire. You know, the setting was this terrible government that was oppressive. The morals were really cruddy. The government was corrupt. This Bible has nothing to do with what we have going on in our life. And he wrote it from an island called Patmos. And we have a picture of this island of Patmos that I want to show you. And it reminds me of Catalina a little bit as I look at it. It's a nice little island. It's in the Aegean Sea, right off the coast. It's situated between, I'll show you a little picture later, but between Turkey and Greece in the Aegean Sea right there. And it's a beautiful place. But, you know, it's really beautiful until you're told you have to go there and have to stay there and you can't leave. There's some evidence that later on John was released and went back to Ephesus. But for right now, he was stuck here and this was the place. He was going to spend the whole rest of his life right there. Now, I'm thinking it's not quite that bad, but it's bad when you can't choose to leave. And so he was exiled there because of his Christian testimony. Now, in this book, there's some blessings that are promised. If you stay with us for the next few months, blessings that you're going to get. You're going to get blessings if, you know, do you want these blessings? But then you got to read it. And then after you read it, it's there. And then after you take it to heart and you hear it, those three things, you know, you read it, you hear it, and you take it to heart. It's taking the word and putting it into part of your life. Because here's what the blessing is going to be. If you read it and hear it and you take it to heart, you're going to be able to navigate through whatever the next 10 years holds in our existence here on this earth. Because I will guarantee you, and if I'm wrong, I will pay you $100, all right, that what these people were facing right there is worse than what we are going to be facing in the next 10 years. Okay? So I'm just telling you, read it, hear it, and take it to heart. You're going to have a blessing because it's going to help you to live your life right now in these uncertain times. And so why do you want to read it and hear it and take it to heart? Here's why. The time is near. The time is happening all around us. These kinds of things have been going on in the church, actually, for 2,000 years, but it's just now kind of catching up to the United States. If we don't turn from our present course as a nation, we're going to fall into the abyss of what happened with the Roman Empire. And it crumbled from within. It crumbled structurally. It crumbled religiously. It crumbled governmentally. And it crumbled familially. The family was being destroyed in Rome. And we have to look at what our life is. And if we don't change, we're going to be living in these days. Because that's where we're headed. And it starts with us. I don't want to sit out here and blame people out there and say we live in this terrible place. I want to start with us, with the household of God. And I want to call us to a life of holiness. Call us to a life of dedicating our lives to following after Jesus. The time is near. Let's read on a little bit in verse 4 of Revelation 1. John, to the seven churches in the province of Asia. Grace and peace to you from him who is, who was, and is to come, and from the seven spirits before his throne, and from Jesus Christ, who is the faithful witness, the firstborn from the dead, and the ruler of the kings of the earth. Jesus is the ruler of the kings of the earth. Does that give you some peace? Everyone's worried about what these Hanyaks are going to do that are leading our world. We're all worried about it. We're all looking around saying, holy cow, is that the best we got? The good news is that Jesus is the ruler of the kings. That's nice. So, you know, I'm not going to say that. All right, so moving on. If you knew all the things I didn't say, you would be so proud of me. All right, so he's the ruler of the kings and lives to him who loves us. You missed this part of Revelation. It's about Jesus who loves us and has freed us from our sins by his blood. And he's made us to be a kingdom and priests to serve his God and Father. To him be the glory and power forever and ever. Amen. Jesus is the one who's going to rule in righteousness over this world forever and ever, ever and ever. Amen. And if we put our trust and faith in anybody else, we're going to be disappointed. In verse 7, look, he's coming with the clouds. He's coming. It may be Friday, but Sunday's coming. Right? It may look bleak on the earth, but Jesus is coming with the clouds, and every eye will see him, even those who pierced him, and all the people on earth will mourn because of him. When we are going through these next few weeks, we're going to be considering the Christ the cross of Christ. The cross is coming, Easter is coming. Before you can get to Easter, you got to go through the cross. And there's a time in my soul in these next few weeks every year that just mourns a little bit. Because you know who put Jesus on the cross? It wasn't you and it wasn't all those bad Democrats or Republicans. It was me who put Jesus on the cross. And so when I see that, because I recognize my own sinfulness, I'm a little bit mournful in this time of year. Because it leads me to the fact that the price for my rebellion to God was paid by Jesus. So I'm the Alpha and the Omega, says the Lord. All the people on earth will mourn because of him. So shall it be. Amen. I am the Alpha and the Omega, says the Lord God, who was, or who is, and who was, and who is to come, the Almighty. So he's writing this, John says in verse 4, to the seven churches. Now here's a little map of these seven churches. And it says that it's in Asia, and it is technically Asia. But we would recognize this area where it says Asia on the map is really Western Turkey in modern days. Just to the left of that is the Aegean Sea. And then to the left of that, to the far left of your map, would be Greece and the Balkan states. And so this letter is written to these churches. Revelation was written to a group of churches specifically. We'll see that in just a minute. And you can see where these are all located, all in one area. There's Pergamum, Smyrna, Ephesus, Thyatira, Sardis, Philadelphia, and Laodicea. You can see all of those churches are all clustered together. They're not very far apart. But yet they're different kinds of churches. We're going to see that in the next few weeks. But John here paints this picture of God. And the picture of God that he paints, he says he is, he was, and is to come. It's interesting that in this picture of God, he talks about God's eternal existence. He's the uncaused cause of everything. And yet, personally, he's coming again. Everyone is trying to figure out who's the Antichrist. Who is it? Who could it be? Is it Henry Kissinger? Maybe it's Neville Chamberlain. You know who Neville Chamberlain is? Look him up. It's not Wilt's little brother, all right? Okay. Our focus is wrong. Our focus is not necessarily trying to figure out who the beast is going to be and who the Antichrist is and all this. Our focus needs to be that Jesus is coming. Look, he's coming in the clouds, it says in verse 7. Look, that's where your focus is to be. And if your focus is on Jesus, when he comes, you're going to see him. And it's going to be sweet. But if you're focused on who the Antichrist is, you might just miss Jesus in the midst of all of that. So who are these seven spirits? That's kind of weird. Well, the seven spirits are the Holy Spirit, actually. The seven spirits before his throne is the Holy Spirit. There's only one spirit, obviously. But the number seven is in Book of Revelation, as we come through this, it's a symbol of completeness. The Jewish readers of the times would know that it's a fullness and a completeness. The seven spirits of God is the fullness and completeness of the Trinity. It's Jesus, the Father, and the Spirit. And the Spirit, the seven spirits, is the fullness of that person of the Trinity, the Holy Spirit. We'll talk some more about him a little bit later. But this number seven depicts him in his fullness. In his all of his glory and fullness, he sends grace and peace to all the believers. You know, he sends this spirit of grace and produces peace in our lives. And here he is seen in the glory of the presence of the Father in heaven. And then there's also a picture here of Jesus. And Jesus Christ, it says that this is not just a revelation from Jesus, but it's the revelation of Jesus. Remember the apocalypse, that word is an unveiling. The purpose of this book is a grand unveiling of the person of Jesus for who he really is. Because the world has seen him as the meek Savior of the world going to the cross, but the world is going to be unveiled to show him as he is, as the coming King. And there's some things, I love these descriptions. He says he's the firstborn. You know, it's important, the firstborn of a father who is a king, the firstborn is the next king. He's the heir to the throne. And you know, you can have an interview with Oprah if you want, but that doesn't change the fact that you're not the firstborn. Harry's never going to be the king, especially now. But listen, Jesus is the firstborn. Jesus here, he says that he is the ruler of kings. The ruler of the kings. All the kings of the earth bow down to Jesus. Look at what else it says. He loves us. The ruler of all the kings loves you. My goodness. How many of you know the president? How many of you know the president before him? How many of you know the president before him? I mean, you know their names, right? But you don't know who they are. Listen, the king of the universe knows you and loves you. He loves us. He frees us from the power and the penalty of sin. He made us a kingdom. Kingdom of God, it lives in you. No matter what, the kingdom of God is strong. And he made us priests. All of us. You guys are all priests. There's no priests in here. I'm not a priest any more than you're a priest. And you are a priest, so I'm a priest. We're all priests. We all represent God to others. We bring God to others. We bring others to God. That's the role of a priest. And all of you, where the priesthood of the believers is a big part of what we believe, that we have access to the throne of God and we can bring other people with us to that throne. And we represent God to man and man to God. And we intercede before the king on other people's behalf. And we also intercede, we bring God to other people. We're priests and we're a kingdom. And he has this Jesus, he has glory and power. He's the beginning and the end, and Jesus himself is the Almighty God. Colossians says, by him all things consist. Do you know what it is that holds atoms together? Because, you know, atoms have a nucleus and electrons and protons and those things all spinning around, you know? You know what holds that all together? It's just Jesus. The Almighty. So what specific things are revealed about God here? There's three things. First is that he's a Trinity. That's really going to be important as we go through this. The Trinity of God. Father, Son, Spirit. And what does that mean? We're going to explore that later. But just keep that in your mind. But just briefly, it means that he's relational. The Trinity is it shows that God himself is in relationship with himself, with the Father, Son, and the Spirit, but he also wants to be in relation with us. He created us in his image. He created us to have relationships. You can't go this on your own. You need each other. But the other thing that's revealed about God in this passage is that he's in control. He's in control. As wonky as everything is in this world, God is in control. So we can rest in that. It's kind of a nice thing, actually. All right, let's look at these next verses. In John 9, or 1, 9, excuse me, in Revelation 1, 9 through 19, John has this vision of Christ. And so he's hanging out one day, and all of a sudden, he just gets this vision of Jesus. And he says in verse 9, I, John, your brother and companion in the suffering and kingdom and patient endurance that are all ours in Jesus, was on the island of Patmos because of the word of God and the testimony of Jesus. He got exiled to this island of Patmos. And he's off the coast, stuck here, can't leave. And it says, I turned around to see the voice that was speaking to me. So he was standing there, here's a voice behind him, and he turned around to see what it was. It's really odd when that happens. My TV did a weird thing the other day. It was talking. Remember we were watching TV, and then all of a sudden, this voice, it was bouncing off the back of my TV. And it was like someone was talking like up and over to the side, and I'm like, whoa, hey. It wasn't Jesus. But I turned around to see the voice that was speaking to me, and when I turned, I saw seven golden lampstands. Now, I want you to get a sense of how weird this is. Some of you might have been children of the 60s and may have seen stuff like this. All right? But this is not normal. I turned around and when I turned, I saw seven golden lampstands, and among the lampstands was something like a son of man. It was something like that, dressed in a robe reaching down to his feet and with a golden sash around his chest. And the hair on his head was white like wool, as white as snow, and his eyes were like blazing fire. That's intense. And his feet were like bronze glowing in a furnace. Have you ever seen metal heated up so hot that it starts to turn red and glowing? That's what his feet were doing. His hair was white, his eyes were burning like fire, and his feet were... And his voice was like the sound of a rushing waters. Have you ever been to a really raging waterfall? It was overwhelming to him. In his right hand, he held seven stars. You know what the star you're most familiar with that is closest to you is? Do you know what that is? The sun. So you could see somebody holding one sun, but seven of them. And coming out of his mouth was a sharp double-edged sword, and his face was like the sun shining in all its brilliance. I want to pause for a second and reflect on this image. Can you imagine how you would react seeing that? It's incredible. But this is John's experience. And he's like, whoa. Now, John hung out with Jesus when Jesus was on the earth. John knew Jesus. And now he's looking at this vision of Jesus. And if we get too stuck on the literalness and try to figure out what everything meant, you know, what does it mean that he had white hair? Be happy with white hair. But you can read so much into that. I don't think that was his point. I think the point was, it was just so amazing. And I don't think we have to dissect down to what each individual thing means, because we really don't know. But what we do know is that it was just overwhelming to him. And how do I know it was overwhelming to him? Because the next verse, verse 17, it says, when I saw him, I fell at his feet as though dead. I laugh at people who say, I'm going to get up to heaven and I'm going to give God a what for. I just laugh at people. I say, you're an idiot, man. What? You're not going to do that. You're going to be like John. You're going to fall at his feet as though you're dead. You will be. But anyways, then he placed his right hand on me, and he said, don't be afraid. In the midst of all this glory and grandeur, he said, don't be afraid. I'm the first and the last. You know, Ron, all your life you've been thinking it's all about you, bro, but really it's me, because I'm the first and the last. He says, don't be afraid, though. I'm the living one. I was dead, and now look, I'm alive forever and ever, and I hold the keys of death and Hades. Write, therefore, what you have seen, what is now, and what will take place later. The mystery of the seven stars you saw in my right hand and the seven golden lampstands is this. The seven stars are the angels of the seven churches. So churches have their own angels. I wonder what our angel looks like who's protecting us right now. Kind of cool. Seven stars are the angels of the seven churches. The seven lampstands are the seven churches. So he showed him this great vision and then explained what it meant. We're going to go into some more depth about what those meant next week. But listen, just we'll wrap this up here. We have a God who speaks. A God who speaks. God is not silent to us. Whoever we are as a church and whoever we are individually with God, he speaks to us. He has a message for us. And sometimes it comes through someone's mouth who's teaching. Sometimes it comes through reading from the Word. But God is not silent. Sometimes just speaks to us through the beauty of nature. But John sees and he hears. He sees the risen and glorified Jesus. And he hears encouragement. That's why I'm here. I'm here to encourage you. I'm not here to condemn you. Sometimes it might feel that way when I'm preaching, but that's not my intention here. My intention is to encourage you. Because if you feel bad, that's just God's Spirit saying, hey, you got some things you got to work on. My encouragement to you is that God, even though he's great and marvelous and sinless and totally perfect, is that he wants to come to you and be in relationship with you. And he wants to encourage you. So here's the encouragement. This is what John hears. He hears encouragement. He realizes his lack when he stands before God, but his encouragement is this from God. Don't be afraid. I'm the first and the last, the Alpha and the Omega. I am living. I was dead, but now I'm alive. And that's hope for us, my friends. It's hope for us, those that have gone before us, and those that will come after us, is that we were dead and now we're alive. And Jesus said, I hold the keys of death and Hades. I'm the one who's in charge of that business. Keys in the scriptures are always symbols of power and authority. Jesus has power and authority over death. Those same keys that will lock up death and Hades are the ones that are going to unlock the gates of heaven. It's not St. Peter standing at the gate. That is some apocryphal writing. It's not Peter at all. It's Jesus. And he says in the scriptures in the Gospel of John, I am the gate. So this vision sets the stage. And the instruction after the encouragement, so he gives us this encouragement and then the instructions. He says, hey, look, let me show you what this means. The seven stars are just angels, and I'm giving them to you. The seven lampstands, there's seven menorahs there, and these are the seven churches in Asia Minor. He's paving the way for what's coming in the next few verses. But this vision sets the stage. And it sets the stage of Jesus standing in the middle of the church of the past, the present, and the future, and he's sending out his messengers. He's communicating with his people. That's what Jesus is saying here with the stars and the lampstands.
But this vision is setting the stage because in verse 19, he gives us the key to understanding the whole book. You ready? Here it is. This is the key, I think, to the whole book of Revelation is in verse 19. And it's found in his message to John. He says in verse 19, to write what you have seen, what is now, and what will take place later. So the key to what this writing of the gospel or of the book of Revelation is that John is going to write down the things that he's seen, the things kind of that were happened already, and then write down the things that are happening, what is going on, and then what's going to happen in the future. Okay? And I think if we look at this book and with that kind of a lens, what's going on then, what had already transpired, and then what was coming in the future, that will give us the key to unlock so much of the things we're going to see later. So this message was to the seven churches, and it was a picture of what was happening to them, but it was also a picture of what was going to happen in the future. So we're going to see that, okay? You got to come back later for more, though. But much of the prophecy of Scripture has an immediate fulfillment and then a later fulfillment. Eschatologists would say that there's types and antitypes, but again, we're not going to get stuck in the weeds of that kind of stuff. We're going to be seeing here this immediate and future fulfillments, and it's going to occur time and time again in this study. One fulfillment for the immediate time, one for the future, and we're going to see how that plays itself out. So what's the application for today? This is it. And then you can go. And thank you all for your time here. First application, read it, hear it, take it to heart. That's the first thing. Read the scriptures, hear what it's really saying, and put it into your heart. Observe it, interpret it, and apply it. Put that into your life. The scriptures need to teach you. The word of God needs to be a centerpiece of your life. Second thing is this, is our Trinitarian God wants to be in a relationship with us. The Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit have the perfect relationship with themselves. Three different persons, one God. Let me know when you get that all figured out. Okay. I've heard all of the analogies. They all kind of, it's like a three-legged dog. It just kind of breaks down after a while. You know, they can't chase you very far. One of the last times I ever was jogging was on this street right here, 14th Street. A three-legged bulldog was chasing me. I outran that dog because he only had three legs. Analogies are just three-legged dogs, all right? So that's the way it is with the Trinity. We'll talk more about that. But our Trinitarian God wants a relationship with us. And then the last thing, here's the last thing, and I just want to just leave you with this. He is in control. Our Trinitarian God, who wants a relationship with us, speaks to us through his word, and he is in control. He's in control of your past. He's in control of your future. And of your present. And we can rest in that the creator of the universe is interested in your life right here, right now. All right? So let's stand together and let's pray, and we'll see you back here next week. Let's pray together. Lord, we want to thank you this morning for your word, and thank you for Jesus who lived and died and came back from the dead. And who is waiting in heaven for that precise right moment to come and take us to be with him. And so, Lord, I just pray now as we embark on this study, you have promised a blessing if we will read this and we will hear it and we'll take it to heart, Lord. And so we do, and we ask for your help as we try to figure out what this means for our lives. Lord, thank you for being mighty. Thank you for being great, and thank you for loving us. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Sing this together.
How great is our God? Sing with me. How great is our God? and all will see how great is our
that out, name above.
Great God we serve. Amen, church. Amen. May God bless you. May God keep you.